Okay, here we go. And tonight we're going to talk about the three Montys. So on to the first Monty, who is a very, very famous British Monty, Bernard Law Montgomery, or General Montgomery, Field Marshal Montgomery, in fact. He was born in 1887 in Kennington, Surrey. He had a pretty unremarkable childhood. He went to public school, and like all public school boys, after finishing school, he went into the army as an officer in the army. He had a pretty heroic World War I. He was wounded twice. He was shot once in the lungs and once in the knee. And he ended the war as a lieutenant colonel. And here in the bottom picture, you can actually see him there. And the figure in front of him is actually none other than Winston Churchill. That in the left is actually, you also see him in the middle, I think. This is Montgomery here. This picture's from the 1920s, where he would earn his spurs in the British Army, dealing with the insurrection in Ireland, dealing with the Shinners, Sinn Féin, or the IRA, as you perhaps better know them. And really, that's how Montgomery learnt to deal with civilian rebellions, which would come in handy in the 1930s, because in the 1930s he was in charge of a division which was tasked with dealing with the Arab revolt. The British Army, the picture you see here is not Montgomery, this is Ord Charles Wingate, who led the Special Night Service, which was a small infantry unit formed from British soldiers and Jews that went around, particularly the Galil, trying to, in a very active way, deal with the Arab rebellion, and quite a brutal way as well. Ord Charles Wingate was a very eccentric figure. He was known to give orders out when he came out of the shower, completely nude. He went around with garlic around his neck, and he was an extremely, extremely eccentric figure. He became a committed Zionist, and that actually earned him also the fact that he became very, very associated with the Jewish will for the Zionist cause. It actually earned him he became very disliked amongst other officers in the British Army, including Montgomery. Montgomery was, it wasn't just Wingate who could be brutal. Montgomery obviously was fairly brutal in Ireland, and he was fairly brutal in Palestine as well. And Edward Keith Roach, who was the senior colonial officer, he wrote in his diary that a local Anglican clergyman came to him protesting about an army atrocity at the village of Albassa. And he was absolutely bewildered. Why was this Anglican clergyman bewildered? Because every question he asked, Montgomery had one reply, which was, "I shall shoot them." And the Anglican clergyman came to the conclusion that the man is bloody mad. And that's what the bishop told Roach. Montgomery was perceptive as well. He said, "The Jew murders the Arab, and the Arab murders the Jews. And this is what is going on in Palestine now, and it will go on for the next 50 years in all probability." And of course, in that he was completely correct. In 1939, in April 39, when he heard that the British had basically defeated the Arab revolt, Montgomery said, "I shall be sorry to leave Palestine in many ways, as I have enjoyed the war out here." And the picture on the right, which I never talked about, the British, as I mentioned, it wasn't just the Special Night Squad, the British also brutally put down the Arab revolt. And here you see a troop carrier, a British train. You can see the officers in the back, and they're protected by this arrangement at the front, where two Arabs would ride at the front of the train, so that if any explosives were placed on the tracks, the Arabs would blow up their own kind. Of course, that had the effect of killing a lot of Arabs. It didn't in any way protect British soldiers. Montgomery is most known for the Battle of El Alamein in October and November of 1943. The British had suffered, not just the British, the Americans who had come into the war. The Americans were in full retreat in the Pacific. The Russians were retreating in Russia against the Germans. And the British had been in full retreat since World War II started. And Montgomery's El Alamein was basically the turning point of the Second World War, the point when the Allies actually started to push the Germans eventually back towards Berlin. And the Battle of El Alamein was particularly poignant for the Jews that were living in Palestine, the Jews of the Yeshuv. Here you can see at the bottom, you can see a trench that's a recent picture taken from the Carmel, but it's a World War II trench. And the British trained the Palmach. The idea was that when the Germans rolled into Palestine, the British would, of course, pull out, and the Jews of the Palmach would be left as a resistance force to harass the Germans, particularly. And of course, the Palmach were a lot of them were German speakers as well, so they would be able to pass themselves off as Germans, The fear that the Germans, would come into Palestine and exterminate the Yeshuv was very real. In fact, the Germans had even sent SS, the SS to Greece, 22 SS soldiers, the Einsgruppen, who were meant to, afterward, when Rommel rolled into Palestine, they were meant to go and lead the extermination of the Jews of the Yeshuv, and of course the Mufti and his henchmen were enrolled to help in killing off the Jews. And there was even a plan for the whole Yeshuv, for all the Jews, to encamp to the Carmel Mountains, where maybe they would have some kind of protection against the Germans. This was given a 50-50% chance of working. Who knows whether it would work, but fortunately, they never had to put that into practice. Okay, so Montgomery's connection with Palestine didn't actually even end with the Second World War. After the Second World War, the British are left in Palestine, and now instead of having to deal with Arab insurrection, now they're having to deal mainly with Jewish terrorism. And on the 16th to the 17th of June was the famous Night of the Bridges, where the Palmach blew up 11 bridges which connected Palestine to the countries that surrounded Palestine. And in response to that, Alan Cunningham, who was the British High Commission, he returned to London to consult with Montgomery as what to do. And they came up with this plan, which was called Operation Agatha. The chief of the Secretariat, Sir John Shaw, he outlined the plan in a press conference in Jerusalem. And he said large-scale operations have been authorized in an effort to end the state of anarchy existing in Palestine and to enable law-abiding citizens to pursue their normal occupations without fear of kidnapping, murder, or being blown up. Montgomery added on another aim, which was to restore the morale of the army, who had basically become sitting ducks for Jewish terrorism. And that's just a newsreel from the time.
In the great synagogue at Tel Aviv, stolen uniforms of many British regiments and bales of forged bearer bonds of the Palestine government have been discovered, in addition to a portable radio transmitter and quantities of illegal weapons and explosives. All this came to light when a false wall in the synagogue was found. The Jewish temple keeper was placed under arrest. 200,000 Jews are being checked by two divisions of British troops and Palestine police. 25,000 people are being interrogated each day. Our troops, in sternly guarded surroundings, are looking for members of the notorious Irgun Sfai Lyume and the Stern Gang, suspected of blowing up the King David Hotel in Jerusalem. With an obvious reason to rejoice are the Arabs, who express themselves in a dance of jubilation.
Okay, so I think actually the newsreel might be a little bit later, because if I'm not mistaken, the blowing up of the King David was actually in July, but you got the picture. And now on to the next Monty, who is Moses Montefiore. He really was a Monty, because his wife Judith called him Monty. And who was he? He was a Jew. He was born in 1784 in Livorno in Tuscany, but his parents, who were originally Italian, they were actually living in London, and he was brought up in Kennington, London, which is a very, very strange coincidence, which I didn't realise, because Kennington, of course, we previously mentioned in the context of General Montgomery being born there. Moses Montefiore, he went to school, but he never finished school because he had to go out and work. He was initially a tea merchant, and then he worked in the city of London in a counting house, which I think was Jewish. He was a Jewish accountant, basically. But anyway, in 1812, he made the best decision of his life. He married Judith Cohen. And even better for him was when Judith Cohen's sister married into the Rothschild family. And where he worked in this counting house, they did the books for the Rothschild, but he became a close friend and business partner of Nathan Rothschild. And together with Rothschild, they invested in stocks and shares, and he made an absolute fortune. So much so that by the age of 40, Montefiore was, well, he would be a millionaire by today's standards, but he had enough money that he was able to retire. In 1837, he was knighted by Queen Victoria, who described Montefiore as an excellent man. Lord Shaftesbury described Montefiore, he said, the grand old Hebrew is better than many Christians. And Lord Shaftesbury, I'm not sure he was such a friend of the Jews. When they voted on allowing Jews into the Houses of Parliament, Lord Shaftesbury actually voted against. But in any case, Montefiore wasn't the first Jew to sit in Parliament. That would be reserved for Rothschild. And Montefiore, when he made his fortune, he basically said, okay, what am I going to do with my life? I am going to devote the rest of my life for philanthropy and basically looking after Jews spread around the world. And by George, they needed him. Of course, the situation of the Jews in Russia was absolutely desperate. Here you see Montefiore in his Sheriff of London's, he was the Sheriff of London, which was an honorary title. He looked extremely grand, and he went out and he managed to get an audience with Nicholas I, the Tsar, who was a prodigious Jew oppressor, an anti-Semite. The situation of the Jews was horrendous in Russia. And Nicholas I said about the Jews in Russia, Montefiore tried to persuade the Tsar that the Jews were loyal to the Tsar. And Nicholas I, who was well impressed by Montefiore, he said, if only they resembled you. Okay, and the situation of the Jews didn't improve. Montefiore made 7 visits to Palestine, the last being at the ripe old age of 91. His first visit was in 1827. And these visits very much determined Montefiore's life's mission. And they also made him religious-ish. And what I mean by that was, he was so religious that he actually volunteered to be the gabbai of the shul in Ramsgate. I think it's still there. But he was very much a British Jew. Okay, we saw before how all the Gentiles, he was very much the Gentiles' idea of what a good Jew should be. And he was, what does religious-ish mean? Well, he would go to synagogue, presumably in his car on Saturday morning. And then, of course, in the afternoon, he would go and watch Manchester United or watch Ramsgate United playing football, as indeed that's really the way British Jewry functioned, even in my parents' day. Anyway, in 1855, he bought land outside the Jerusalem wall. That was the only piece of land he could get his hands on. And getting any kind of land in Jerusalem was a feat, because up to then, the Ottomans would not sell land to a non-Ottoman citizen. But as I mentioned a few times before, the Crimean War and the Tanzimats, the land reforms of the Ottomans, basically changed that. Montefiore was appointed the executor of Judah Turow's will, Turow being a very rich American Jew. And the land that he bought was meant to be to build a hospital. But in any case, the Rothschilds beat him to it, and they built a hospital inside the old city. By the way, the Jews all lived inside the old city and lived in terrible poverty and awful, there was terrible disease there, cholera and all kinds of other diseases there. The hospital was needed and conditions were awful. But in 1855, the land that he bought, instead of actually building a hospital on it, he decided to build Mishkanot Shalanim. He built 28 1.5 room apartments that you can still see. It still looks like that now in Mishkanot Shalanim. And he basically had to bribe Jews to move out of the old city into Mishkanot Shalanim. Why? Because first of all, they didn't want to be the pioneers, the first to live outside the wall. No way, not me. And also, to be fair to them, it was dangerous there. It was not protected by a wall. There were bandits and thieves and goodness knows what. So Montefiore actually really had to pay them to live there. He wasn't actually so keen on that, because Montefiore was very much of the principle of divvying up money to enable Jews to work. And to that end, he would build the famous windmill that we see today in Yamin Moshe. It operated for 20 years. It was never very successful, mainly because, two main reasons. First of all, because it was designed around European wheat. It was unsuitable for the wheat that was grown in Palestine, so it never produced very good flour. And second of all, there just wasn't enough wind in Jerusalem to turn the sails. And after 20 years, it fell into disrepair and stopped being used. And mills that were in Jerusalem started to be powered by steam. Of course, the Arabs objected to the windmill. They sent a cadi to curse the windmill. And in the late 19th century, anyway, the windmill was abandoned. In the 1930s, under the British mandate, the windmill would be restored by the British Pro-Jerusalem Society, but it looked a little bit different. Here's a picture from 1880, and whoops, here's a picture from 1930. Well, it's actually a recent picture, but the windmill in the 1930s looked like that. So it's got a cap, it's got sails, but these sails couldn't turn at all. In 1948, the windmill was used by the Haganah. It was the forward point with a great view over the Arabs that were in the old city. It was used by the Haganah, and the British had basically decided to blow up the mill. Here you see the mill being blown up, but luckily the British sent engineers from the army to blow it up. They saw a plaque that was dedicated to Montefiore and mentioned Ramsgate, which was where Montefiore was from, and luckily the sappers were also from Ramsgate, so they decided they had to carry out their orders. What did they do? They blew up the top of the mill, so it couldn't be used anymore by the Haganah, but they actually didn't blow up the whole structure. In 1967, the windmill was restored. So it looked like this until about 2012, when functional sails were developed. Functional sails were bought, basically, from the land of the windmill from Holland, was sent over, and the windmill was reconstructed. You see, it now looks like that, which is very similar to what it looked like in 1880. And in 2012, the windmill produced its first bag of ground flour. And onto another Montefiore construction, which is Rachel's tomb. So in 1828, the tomb was visited by Montefiore and his wife Judith. Of course, the tomb is associated with Rachel Imenu, the wife of Yaakov. And as we know, Rachel was barren, and it became the site where barren women would pray. And Judith Montefiore went there to pray for a child, which unfortunately she would never have. In 1841, the structure as we know it now was basically built by Montefiore, who obtained the keys, he paid for renovations, and there were further renovations in 1845. But just as an aside, this is, for those of us that have been to Rachel's tomb now, you go to get there, you have to go through this amazing concrete road, which has concrete on either side, massive walls, 468 meters on either side of concrete, because Rachel's tomb is basically in Lev Bet Lechem, in the heart of Bet Lechem being Area A, which is administered by the Palestinians. And so the story goes, nice story, but it's not connected to Montefiore at all, that in 1995, just before Bet Lechem was passed over to the Palestinians, Hanan Porat, who was a right-wing MK, he was a heroic figure himself. He was going in to talk to Rabin about Rachel's tomb, and Rav Menachem Porush of the Agudat Yisrael, he asked Porat if he could go in to the meeting with him. And Porat said, okay, you can come in. Porat sits in front of Yitzchak Rabin with all these maps, and he's trying to persuade Yitzchak Rabin not to give Rachel's tomb back to the Palestinians. He's making no impression on Rabin at all. Suddenly, Menachem Porush starts crying and tears running down his face. He grabs hold of Rabin, his tears fall on Rabin's chest, and he says, Yitzchak, how can you give back Mamala Ruchi? How can you give back the tomb of Rachel? And Yitzchak Rabin is so moved by that he agrees to invest millions and millions of dollars to build this kind of concrete structure, which would mean that Jews today are still able to get to Rachel's tomb and to pray there, despite the fact that it's in the middle of Bet Lechem. And in a very strange and perhaps tragic turn of fate, the night that Rabin was assassinated was actually the yard site, what is held as the yard site of Rachel Imenu. And finally, to the last Monty, which is of course Monty Python.
We'll have two with points and a big flat one.
Can I have a flat one, Mum?
Shh!
Sorry, Dad.
Yeah, all right, 2 points, two flats and a packet of gravel.
Packet of gravel. Should be a good one this afternoon.
Yeah?
Local boy.
Oh, good.
Enjoy yourselves.
Mathias, son of Deuteronomy of Gath?
Well, I say yes.
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 You have been found guilty by the elders of the town of uttering the name of our Lord. And so, as a blasphemer, you are to be stoned to death.
Look, I'd had a lovely supper, and all I said to my wife was, that piece of halibut was good enough for Jehovah.
Blasphemy! He said it again! Did you hear him? Are there any women here today? Very well. By virtue of the authority vested in me...
Oh, lay off! We haven't started yet!
Come on! Who threw that? Who threw that stone? Come on! Sorry, I thought
we started.
Go to the back.
Oh dear.
Always one, isn't there?
Now, where were we?
Look, I don't think it ought to be blasphemy. Just saying Jehovah.
For yourself?
Making it worse? How could it be worse? Jehovah, Jehovah, Jehovah!
I'm warning you, if you say Jehovah once more, right, who threw that? Come on, who threw that?
Was it you?
Yes.
Right,
well, you did say Jehovah.
Now look, no one is to stone anyone until I blow this whistle. Do you understand? Even, and I want to make this absolutely clear,
even if they do say Jehovah.
Ah, that's it for tonight. And I'll try and mute you.